within the AOG, but I'm not going to now, and I don't feel that's correct given what the Lord has already said. So just something that I want to reiterate, and what Father has been saying already, teach and every one of us to him or her who has ears, listen to what the Spirit is saying. If your physical ears are open, you're listening. But if your spiritual ears are opening, that's doing something deeper. And that's what God wants to do with each and every one of us. Something deep within our spirits. And the outworking of that can sometimes affect our physical bodies. Hallelujah. We believe in physical healing. Many of us have experienced physical healing. When I say physical healing, I mean supernatural healing through the Holy Spirit. Some of us haven't. Some of us have been disappointed. Some of us are living with that disappointment. It's interesting with Ralph, and yeah, he's right, he shared this with me a few weeks ago. We went away together for a weekend to The Gathering, which is a Christian men's conference. And the minister who leads that, fantastic man, who I think models himself on the pub landlord. He really does. He's brilliant. He has Parkinson's. He's got Parkinson's. He's still working for the Lord, but he's an inspiration because he hasn't been healed yet. And just like Ralph said, if he doesn't get healed, he's still with the Lord. What are the words of Paul? You know, what does Paul say? Okay, we scrabble around to spend another minute or hour or day or week or year or decade on planet Earth. But to be with Jesus is far, far better. To be with him is far better. I'm not denying that if your young people die, etc., that's difficult. It's difficult to cope with. Older people who've lived a full life, we still don't really want to die. We want to stay around as long as we can. But the Lord knows what we need. He knows what we need. He knows what healing you need. And for all of us, that's spiritual healing, above and beyond physical, for each and every one of us here. So just a few words. I'm conscious of the time, and we'll see where this goes. Hebrews chapter 1. We've been worshiping this man Jesus this morning. We've been praising him. We've been thanking him. We've been praying to him. We've been singing about him. Amy shared about the cross. The cross has indeed said it all. The supreme sacrifice for you and I. And in Hebrews 1, we read these words. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets. So he's talking about the Israeli nation, the Hebrew nation. God raising up prophets. Peter shared about Elijah and Elisha. Two of the greatest known prophets who spoke to both Israel and Judah when the two kingdoms were split. They were united under David. And God, it says, in a former time, raised up prophets to speak to his nation. And yet he says, but in these last days has spoken to us by his Son. Hallelujah. Whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds. Let's just pause there. Is that mind-blowing? Through whom created the worlds. Planet Earth, our solar system, our galaxy, the galaxies, the universe. God created it through Christ, his Son. And it says he's spoken to us in these last days. So 2,000 years ago when these words were written to Hebrew Christians, by most people reckon Paul, some say not, but whoever wrote it was saying in these last days, that's 2,000 years ago. How much further into the last days are we now? And Peter mentioned eschatology. It's a wonderful theological word. The theology of end times, from Christ to now, and what will happen. in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son. How is he speaking to you this morning? By Jesus Christ, through his Son. 2,000 years ago, the cross spoke to the world. Prior to that, Jesus had disciples, we know. He healed and taught and preached across his nation and beyond the Jewish nation. Today he speaks to you and I through his Spirit and through his Word. We've heard already today, please, please, please don't take for second hand or third hand what the Bible teaches. Don't take it from me. Whatever I'm saying, will you go home and check that what I'm saying is accurate, that Scripture actually teaches it, that I'm not teaching heresy, that I've not gone off a tangent. Too many people will sit in church, listen, go away, and not check out what's been said. If I'm wrong, come back and tell me. I don't do it deliberately, okay? If I'm wrong, it's because I've been mistaken. Or I've just got a bit excited and said something incorrectly. We all do that sometimes. But it's really important that you read the Bible. It's God's love letter to you, fundamentally. And if you don't believe me, let me ask you, when you go home, take the Bible, if you've got a Bible, turn to the Gospel of John and read it. Read God's love letter to you. He loves you. Regardless of what you're going through, he loves you. And we've all been through life. We're all going through life, whatever that is. It may be something physical. It may be that the ill health in our body. It may be something emotional or psychological. Tara deals with that regularly. People are broken in their minds. Something, life has got so difficult that the mind is just unable to take it. It may be a spiritual malaise. You may have dealt with religion before, been to church before, and somewhere in that you've been broken. But God is the healer. God is the healer. And he wants to write the prescription for your life today. Let me encourage you. Go back, open the Gospel of John, and just read God's love letter to you. In these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son, whom he's appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds, who, being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power. Wow. If you've seen the Father, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, Jesus said. Now, of course, we know the Scripture also says you cannot see the Father and live. You cannot see God and live. We understand that. It's an attenuation. God minimizing himself sufficiently so that we're not blown up by seeing him. But God becoming human, because he deals with us as humans, God coming down to our level as a speck of dust to speak to other specks of dust. Amen? But he's still the image of the Father. All of that he is, and it says, when he had himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. When he died on the cross, when he shed his blood, when he said, this is how much I love you, on the cross, for you and for I. When he'd done that, we're told he sat at the right hand of the glory of the Father, the majesty on high, interceding for you and I, still at work, still loving, still caring, still enabling you and I to worship him in spirit and in truth. In these last days. And it's interesting, I turned to that and I'm thinking, what does it say? Oh yeah, I just bookmarked Romans chapter 5. Funny old thing. Romans 5 verse 6. For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. So the Lord Jesus Christ died for you and for me when we didn't deserve it. You don't have to be good. You don't have to be beautiful. You don't have to be handsome. You don't have to, I'm trying not to look at anyone. You don't have to be, just sort of general. You don't have to be educated. You don't have to be high ranking, high status. It doesn't matter to God. At the right time, God died for you. And we've been told already, maybe somebody here, that right time is now, is today. He loves you. He wants you to know, he wants you to experience his love. Not at arm's length, not at a distance, not at, you know, 1 hour or 2 hours at church on Sunday, but an intimate, the most intimate, wonderful relationship you've ever had. Now, regardless of what your relationship has been with human beings, your partner, your spouse, your brothers, your sisters, your siblings, your aunties, regardless of all of that, no matter how good a relationship you've had, God promises you a better relationship with his Son by his Spirit. If you will say yes, take that step forward. It's a step into the unknown. You're absolutely right. Yes, it might feel like you're on the edge of a precipice. Yes, you don't know what lays in store. Oh, what about these religious funny people? I don't want to be one of them. That's what I said. That's what I said 40 years ago. And I didn't know. But my prayer, and I've shared this before, my first ever proper prayer, not just going through rote, reading the Lord's Prayer. And by the way, we sang the Lord's Prayer today. What a beautiful chorus. Thank you, Jill and the team, for bringing that to us. Not because you can do that, can't we? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. You could do that without even thinking. And I've done it quite a lot without thinking what I was saying. But my first proper prayer, when I realized there was a God and I was not him, you know, because we like to be the masters of our own fate. And that if there is a God, then the warning in Scripture and the promises in Scripture, heaven and hell, there's a promise of heaven and a warning about an eternal separation, an eternal life without him. We will not be destroyed. There is eternity. There's a warning. And it got to the point where I thought, well, if I die now, I don't know where I'm going. I have no assurance, no comfort, nothing to do with eternity. So my first ever prayer was, God, if you are there, I need you. That was my prayer of salvation. That was it. And God showed up. That was my one little step forward to God. And wow, he came. He showed up, transformed me. And by his grace, and thankfully, he's still transforming me today because I'm not very good. I've got a long way to go, even after 40 years. Who's got a long way to go? Most of us, yeah. We have, haven't we? Isn't it annoying? I don't know, a day later, do you wake up one day and think, I'm perfect, hallelujah, look at me, hey. Abigail and I were watching Bruce Almighty last night. Well, if you've watched the film, it is quite funny, isn't it? What would we do if we were God? So I wake up the following morning thinking, hallelujah, I'm perfect, I'm never going to do anything wrong ever again. Oh dear, how long did that last? Not even that day, probably. And what I was going to share about is humanity. We can't think right thoughts all the time. We can't say right words all the time. Very difficult to do right actions all the time. Our human nature is against God, but he still loves us and he calls us into his kingdom. So can I ask you, don't let this day end without taking that step towards God. Don't let it end. For when we were still without strength, and none of us have strength, Christ died for the ungodly. He wants to make you godly today. He wants to call you into a relationship with him today. He wants to change you from the inside out. He wants to heal your wounds, whatever those wounds are, emotional, mental, psychological, maybe even physical. Certainly spiritual. We're all wounded spiritually in some way, shape, or form. God, by his Spirit, says, I love you. I want to heal you. Just come to me. Reach out, and you will find me. That's his promise today for each and every one of us. And for those of us who've been walking with the Lord for any length of time, It doesn't change. It's still his promise for us now. Don't get bored of knowing Jesus. If you got a bit bored, got a bit apathetic, oh, Sunday again, I've got to read my Bible. Church, I'd rather stay in the duvet. There were some people, sadly, and I can't remember which church this was, but they were threatening to stop their online services. It was a large church somewhere. And they're threatening to stop their online services. So they do the online services still because there are some people who are housebound, so can't come. And I get that. But there are plenty of people who are not housebound, who've just got so used to staying in their duvet, having their mocha chocolate, frappuccino, whatever, and watching the service on TV. And for them, that's it. Well, it was okay during COVID-ish, maybe, regardless of what you think about the lockdowns and all that. But that was then, this is now. They don't want to come back to be amongst the great unwashed. What's that about? They don't want to be with folk again. They want to be in the comfort of their own home. But brothers and sisters, we need each other. I need you. Yes, I do, Valdi, I do. We need, Valdi, yes, we need each other. Each and every one is vital, a vital cog here in this fellowship and across the church in Pocklington. You have a gift, you have a talent, so you've got something to bring into the kingdom of God that he can heal you and then set you to work as he sets each and every one of us to work. And somebody who's not at work gets bored. And if you're not at work, you end up doing stuff that you shouldn't really be doing. What's the phrase? The devil finds work for idle hands and minds. So if we're not working for God, we may be working for the other side, and that's not what he wants. So, I'm starting to go around in circles now, because as I said, this is just that little step. I can take a huge step. I've got quite long legs. God says just a little step towards him. That's it. And he will meet you at your point of need. He will meet you where you need to be met. He will heal you where you need to be healed. Don't let another day go by. Don't let another day go by without reaching out to him. Amen.